So this is our panel, so I will conclude today. So yesterday, so we talked about some classical aspects of the transient matrix model, and I computed just the radius, the radius square from the quantum mechanics, and also the classical transient matrix model. Then, so I just say, I forgot about to say about the fitting fluxion using this radius square. So after computation of this radius square, so we can compute this pi r square is the area of the radius. And then we can compute the electron density, rho. Then essentially we can compute a fitting fluxion by following this definition. Then we can identify k as the fitting fluxion. So the original quantum mechanical perspective, so we can compute just a k. That case is k for 1. But if you consider this transient matrix model, then k is now included in this fitting fluxion. Okay, so then I'd like to discuss a quantum aspect, a quantization of the matrix. So maybe I think it's better to write down again the random action. So I just I not included this coefficient here. This quotient principle. So this is a simple tangent. So we can see that these kinetic terms only contain the first. This first order time derivative. So we can identify z as a canonical variable, and the canonical momentum is nothing but z dot. So that's why we can impose the canonical quantization. So here I would like to include the indices. These are gauge indices. Then we see that, already we saw that z is almost like the positions of n electron. And we can understand this as sort of some annihilation operator. So we can define reference states, which is annihilated by z operator. And also annihilated by phi operator. Then we can act phi z dagger and phi dagger on this different state, not this zero state. I call this a reference state. However, so this system contains gauge invariants. So the Gauss law constraints. After the integration of the alpha, we can derive Gauss law constraint. So quantum mechanically, we would like to impose this constraint also. But there is ambiguity since there is a normal ordering process in the quantum mechanical quantization. So I just follow the original procedure by particle knuckles. So we take this normal ordering, so namely the phi annihilation orbital to the left, annihilation orbital to the right, and already you know the creation orbital to the left. So this is a quantum version of the Gauss law operator. So we should impose this condition. I got it by G operator as a Gauss law operator. And all the physical states annihilated by this Gauss law plane. So if you naively just act Z dagger, phi dagger on a reference state, that is not physical state. We have to project out by this constraint. So let's see the implication of this Gauss law operator. So we can separate two parts, the trace part and traceless part. So if you take trace of the Gauss law operator, two meanings from this condition. So what is the, so phi dagger phi is nothing but a number operator. So it means that the phi dagger, this excitation, the number of phi dagger should be Kn for the physical state. On the other hand, if you consider this action as a U1 action, since we have taken a trace. So this means that some U1, this action is U1 of the cartanomic H symmetry, then it tells us the U1 charge of the physical state. So we have N carton, so U1 to N, so we have a charge K for the physical state. That is the meaning for the trace part of the Gauss law constraint.
So the first condition can be viewed as also saying that K must be integer.
Right. That I just discussed. So the traceless part is saying that the physical state should be SUN sigma. So as Eugene said, so this condition tells us the quantization of the level. So essentially, this is number operators. We have to require this integer. However, so the Gauss law operator, original Gauss law operator, we also have a traceless part. So schematically, I denote a ZZ dagger part as the GZ, and phi dagger phi part as G phi. So I'm now writing the traceless part of the Gauss law operators. So we have to impose this condition. And this GZ part, this is a product of GZ dagger, or Z dagger Z, constructed as a product of the adjoint representation. So adjoint action of the Z and Z dagger. So that means, so we can think about this physical state as a representation of the UN, SUN, or you could say UN, for physical state as the sum representation of SUN for traceless part. So in that case, so we can understand this Kn as the number of the boxes corresponding to the Young diagram. So this representation is associated with the Young diagram or some partition. Also, I will talk about something about, so in a computational partition function, I will explain about such a partition or something, some backgrounds. But in that case, the boxes of the Young diagrams should be Kn from this condition, But if you think about this product of adjoint action, this means that the boxes, the number of boxes, should be proportional to n. So that adjoint representation just having the box in number n. So that's why, so these, the all this Gauss law constraints are proportional to n. So these are just a conjugate condition. That's why K should be integer. So now so we can see that K is quantized in the Chancellor matrix model. And classically, we identify this K as the phasing function. So that's why if you think about the chance of matrix models, the feeding fraction is now quantized as the fraction. So that is why if you think about the chance of matrix models, so it has a possibility to describe the fractional quantum Hall effect. Okay, now I would like to discuss what physical state is. How do we construct? So we have to require this condition. So, but this condition tells us firstly, k and phi delta should contain in this state. So we expect some m copies of z data. So at this stage, we do not know the number of m, how many. But we know that the number of phi delta should be kn. So this is a kind of belief expectation. So the problem is, now we would like to construct a SUN singlet using m copies of z data. So the problem is, so how to construct so SUN singlet purely as group theoretical issue programs. So a joint representation contains two indices, A, B, and one index is for the just a fundamental, and the other one is just an anti-fundamental. So this problem can be solved by introducing a symmetric or anti-symmetric invariant tensor. So typically, so we have, so for S, just a UN case, we can introduce that the Kronecker delta or complete so anti-symmetric tensor. So firstly, so we would like to so the singlet means that we have no additional or extra indices. We have to construct all the indices. So how, you know, using these objects, how we can construct all the indices consistently. So first, we'd like to consider the construction of these anti-fundamental indices. So the possibility is that we use the epsilon tensor or adjoint operator z data or z data here. But phi delta is essentially the same. There are no distinctions. So if you contact with this epsilon tensor, essentially it's a vanishing. So that's why only the possibility to contact these indices. So the problem is if you have some flavor indices, then we can. But here we have just the gauge indices. So the phi delta should be taken to be paired with z delta. Of the phi delta and z delta, and an additional extra indices, just a fundamental indices for z. Then how we construct fundamental indices? The remaining thing is this can be used. So that's why we expect. Using these operators. So now we construct all the indices consistently. So n1 to nn is an arbitrary integer. So this is a possible operators acting on a physical space. But we require kn psi delta should exist. So that's why we take the product of this operator. Additionally, we can also trace a conjunctional. We can take a trace of z error and also take a product. So we can take some this type of operators.
So the sum of exponent for z degree is equal to n. In the first one, the sum of the exponent for z degree, n1 plus n2 plus
n1 to nn.
If you sum them up, you get capital N.
So yes, this capital N is just a rank of the pH group. But this small n is any, something.
The power.
Right? Yeah, power.
So the sum of them should be capital N.
In that sense, yes. If you use this notation, but it's kind of arbitrary. Copies. But I include here. That's why it's not coincident with this one.
Okay.
So the general physical states. So if you act additionally, so put these operators, then we can take the minimum basis. We can take the smallest, the minimum numbers for the n1 to n. But the, So please be careful. So the n1 to nn should be different. All the indices should be different because this is epsilon. So unsymmetric tensor, they should be different. So that's why the using the minimal basis, so we can write down in general. Also, Ci is an arbitrary integer.
Determinant along z degree without phi. Because in the first line, essentially you are taking the capital N rank determinant. But the ingredient is phi degree composed with z degree. I'm asking whether you can just take out z. Oh, we cannot.
We cannot because
the charge has to be k.
Right, so this constant is very small. Right. Yeah, so that's why, now we're going to sort of compare with the original Lagrangian wave function here. So now we're going to consider the ground state, because wave function, already we discussed the quantum mechanical system for the electrons. Then the ground state is a minimum excitation. So we take Ci equals 0. That's why the ground state is just a little in terms of this one. So this is a ground state. So now, recall that the Lagrangian wave function identify, well, schematically, you can find out your outcome. Number one, this is a unity, and Z dagger. We have a mapping between the Lauri wave function and this physical space.
Sorry, in your original Lagrangians, do you have kinetic terms for phi?
No, because they do not have any such corresponding operators phi. In the original system, it's two-dimensional electrons.
No, the matrix
Lagrangian. So the chance of matrix model include this phi, because that is.
So what is the physical operator?
So this is actually the some internal freedom of two-dimensional electron system. But now, so it's not so obvious because we do not have some any flavor symmetry. But just display a lot of the pairing of the Z-data here. But if you introduce some flavor symmetry, like phi some fundamental fields, and I run from 1 to p, you could introduce SVP flavor symmetry. So later I will talk about such non-abelian case, a non-abelian flavor symmetry case. Then this gives a non-abelian symmetry in the system, and that plays a lot of some non-abelian quantum Hall system. But anyway, here, so phi is just a complex scalar. It's not obvious to see what it's meaning, but introducing this phi dagger, you can compare with original Lauri wave function. But so the Calabari, Sakita, in 2001, so they computed, so using this ground state, they computed the wave function in the matrix model. So they defined the coherent state in the matrix model. Then as we did for the electron system, so we can take the overlap of Z phi, the coherent state and ground state, then we can define the wave function. But the result is they are not same. But if we take the limit, so where the distance between the electrons is very, very large, the wave function of the matrix model actually coincide with Lauri wave function. I think it might be appropriate because original Lauri wave function also applicable for the this is also the under the assumption. So the Coulomb potential is neglected. So in that sense, so such a large distance for the electrons, this description is, maybe trustable. But anyway, so this is a physical state and ground state. OK, now I'd like to change the topic, the third content. I guess so far, so not so many speakers are talking about a string theory, but some of the title contains string theory. So I would like to mention about, because my title, the third content is relevant to transient Boltzmann. So I should say the result. So the statement is that this transient matrix model is an effective description of the Boltzmann dynamics in a transient theory. But the derivation is basically due to the fact of some Blaine configuration, the Blaine realization of the vortices. That's why I think it might be a good chance to include a string theoretical some Blaine construction if you are interested in. But okay. So let's start with some fundamental things. So what is the vortices? So the vortices is two-dimensional solid, so which is occupying a surface identify a sigma.
Sorry, for interruptions.
Yes.
So in the original actions, do you have this harmonic combining potential?
Yes. So this is sort of a four-dimensional two defects. So if you think about a four-dimensional, the one plus three-dimensional space-time, so this the vortices just behave as just a string. And if you think about a one plus two-dimensional, this is just a particle, vortex particle. So there are three data of determining the vortices. Of course, firstly, the data is the Lehmann surface. So this surface sigma. So they have some particular metric. So this component factors including a two-dimensional, so we can always write down for the Lehmann surface. The second data is the gauge group. G. So in this talk, I will only focus on just the abelian case. And correspondingly, we have gauge group. Mathematically, we can say this is a one form, a connection one form. On the U1-9 bundle. Over sigma. And also we have field strength. In other words, so this is a magnetic field. So essentially, magnetic B is, so using this component factor, we can denote by F12 components. The important data from this gauge field and gauge quantity as a field strength is the vortex number, which is just a topological quantity. So the in the morning session, so the Chan talk about such a topological quantities. But here, so this is associated to the U1 bundle over the just the Lehmann surface. So this is defined as the and if you take this integer, this is known to be integer. So if you take the positive integers for the vortex number, so this is associated vortices. But if you take a negative one, then this is associated anti-vortices. Maybe I will talk about just a positive integer. So this is a very important data of the vortex. So what we can say is the winding number.